Hello then, and welcome to After the Flag from the final round of the World Championship here in Portugal. I'm Steve Day, joined by Simon Crafar, and we'll be getting to hear from the top three, of course, a little bit later on, in a race where Miguel Oliveira has taken his second victory of 2020 in stunning, stunning style. Second was Jack Miller getting a bit of revenge over Franco Morbidelli. Simon, first of all, we have to talk about the race winner here today, Miguel Oliveira, pole to the win. No one even showed him a front wheel. No one could get close to him.
Yeah, even in Parc Fermé, the other riders said, for example, Franco saying untouchable, and Jack Miller saying in the early laps, his pace was unbelievable, you know. They were doing stunning times. So, and he, you know, you saw the lap chart, what he'd done. It was amazing. Like, within a few tenths the whole way. Not a mistake in there. Yeah, a stunning ride.
We're just watching here the world champion photos. An amazing day across the board, of course. We already knew coming into the weekend Joan Mir was champion. Here he comes. It's not been a particularly pretty day for him in terms of the race, but Alberto Reinas and Anaia Bastianini, what drama we had in both of the smaller classes today, Simon.
Yeah. Albert, this is the one I couldn't believe, the risk he took on that last lap. And, I don't know what was going through his mind when he re-watches that. It was, I was so scared for him that he was going to blow it, you know. Almost coming together with other bikes, off the track, losing the rear, all on the last lap, yeah. But he's been something special all year, hasn't he? From the first race at Qatar, really, yeah. Really good. The way he can, you brought it up a few times, the way he enters turns and keeps it on line, and the way he fights, always manages to stay in that front group. He didn't as well today, but I think it was that rear tyre, you know, that he went for the softer one.
Yes.
Everyone he was fighting, except Brad Binder, was on the harder one, and I think that was the choice.
We'll keep our eye on that team photo as they make their way on there. Anaia Bastianini as well, winning the Moto2 World Championship. But I have to say that I thought that coming into today, Anaia would perhaps do it in the most comfortable fashion. But there were a few moments in that race. It must have been a bit nervy for the Italtrans team.
He wasn't as strong as he's shown at previous races. And I think that's what you meant,
yeah.
Right? Yeah, because he was... he's something special, I think, you know. I think he's going to be something special in MotoGP with a bit of time as well. The way he saves stuff, the skill he shows... he's super. He doesn't show any, nerves, fear. He's happy to be there. He's never scared to have a fight in a race, is he? And the saves he does are amazing. He falls off so seldom throughout the season. I think all those things add up to somebody really special coming to MotoGP.
The amazing thing about these pictures here as well is they all know each other so well, because 3 years ago, they were all racing each other in Moto3.
Amazing. Yeah. Yep, and that's the new generation coming through, which I get so excited about. We're getting a big injection of these new guys next year in MotoGP, and as sad as it is to see the older, more experienced riders go, I feel twice the emotion about the new boys coming in.
That Suzuki looks mighty fine, doesn't it, with the number one planted on the front of it. Still no confirmation as to whether he'll sport the number one on his bike going into next season. Where do you sit on that front, Simon?
I think it's a personal thing, you know. Some riders are superstitious, you know, they don't want to...
Branding as well, it helps sometimes, staying with the same number, doesn't it?
Well, I like riders having the same number. In my day, we'd change them. And I, every season you start, you take a while to recognise anyone, especially for the public. And I like riders having their own number. The number one is something special, though, so I could totally understand if Suzuki would like to run it, if Joanna's brave enough and not too superstitious to run it. And, yeah, it'd be really nice to see.
OK, so let's just get into some more analysis as we look at the photos here of the top three from today's race, because we're going to be hearing from them soon, and otherwise it's going to be all a bit messy. So Miguel Oliveira, race win. We didn't know what was going to happen tyre-wise in the race, but quite clearly Miguel didn't have any troubles at all with the hard front, hard rear. There wasn't really a drop-off at all. I mean, OK, his lap time slowed a bit, Simon, but nothing in comparison to what we were expecting.
I mean, part of that drop would be just he had such a big gap, yep. No pressure. He was making sure he got it home. It was, an awesome ride. I mean, again, Miguel, stunning to do those lap times so consistent, and the pace he did right from the start. I also think big thumbs up to KTM because Francesco Guidotti on the grid said that they were a little bit worried about tyre life. They seemed to think the KTM's kept them going better, and that's amazing. I mean, KTM again, a year ago they were the opposite. You know, they'd wear out their rears faster. So amazing, yeah, truly. And there's nothing like a rider winning his home race. You know, that doesn't matter where you go. I'm all for the local boy to win, and he dominated.
In a moment, you're going to see the riders, no doubt, standing on the pegs, the world champions from all three classes there, Albert Arenas, Enea Bastianini and Joan Mir. Here today in Portugal, second place in the end, albeit a long way back from Miguel Oliveira, was Jack Miller. A little bit of personal revenge there on Franco Morbidelli after their intense battle in Valencia last time out. Jack did just about all he could, and he's ended the season in good form. Which will give him a bit of a boost heading to the factory Ducati team next year. And also, we should point out, that has given Ducati the Constructors' title as well.
Didn't realise that about the Constructor title. I agree with you in that Jack's form this year has been really good. Maybe early on, I wasn't sure what was going to happen, but later on in the season, he's always been easy. He's fast all the time, and he's made very few mistakes. You know, he's had a bit of bad luck with engine braking and air tear off in the airbox and stuff like that. But I think he's a worthy factory Ducati rider, you know, worthy of that spot. And, exciting.
Interestingly, Jack Miller finished the season seventh in the championship, Simon, but only 7 points down on third overall.
Yeah, and with that, but I mean, you could say with that bit of bad luck, but the thing is everyone had some during the season, so... Yeah, impressive. I mean, it's crazy competitive, isn't it? And that's why it's so amazing that Miguel managed to do what he did today, because normally that's not possible.
So, yeah, it's the third second-place finish of the season then for Jack Miller. He'll try and go one better in factory colours next year. Third today was the man that was on the top step last week, Franco Morbidelli, and that has secured him second overall in the World Championship. Just generally speaking, an outstanding job this year from Franco Morbidelli.
Yep. He's another rider I love. Like he's, like I've said before, solid. You know, he's calm, makes very few mistakes, is fast, clever, you know, intelligent. There's a few of them, isn't there? And he is, I mean, everyone knows, but he's a serious threat. Let's hope. I think his worry next year is that if Yamaha do make a big step with their... 21 bike, you know, if they make a good progression, that the gap could get bigger. The only saving grace for him is engines are frozen, so they can really only improve chassis stuff, can't they? So,
well, as we see the top three in the world in each class holding hands on the grid, it's time now to cross over to one of the men who finished on the podium today. It's back-to-back podiums and a strong finish to the 2020 season for Jack Miller, and I believe Matt's standing by with the Aussie right now.
Yeah, I am. Thanks very much, Steve.
A very strong finish to 2020 for Jack Miller. A great day for him personally. Second after another really good late battle with Franco Morbidelli. And crucially, he's helped Ducati take their first Constructor Championship, Jack, since 2007. So Ducati are going to be pretty happy with you tonight. I'm sure you're pretty happy with yourself. But before we start, you must be sick of the sights of Franco Morbidelli's backside after these last two weekends.
Yeah, just doing the math, and I think it was about, 60 laps his last two races. But... managed to eventually come over the line, not in behind it, but in front of it this weekend. But it was a shame that Oliveira was just, about another 10 seconds up the road on us. He just had an incredible pace today. Miguel rode an amazing race. I was waiting for him to sort of come back towards us in the second part of the race. Like, Frankie and I weren't going slow. We were pushing low 40s the whole race, some 39s thrown in there. And he was still gapping us. So I take my hat off to him. He rode in a mega race and... also to Frankie for pushing that pace the whole time. We both didn't put a foot wrong the whole race, and there have been some furious, fast-paced races these last couple, and to be back up here on the podium is a great way to finish off the My chapter here in Pramac Racing, you know, over the past 3 years, I've grown a lot as a rider and also as a human, as a man. So I appreciate everything they've done for me. So much. Paolo Campagnotti, Francesco Guidotti, the life lessons they've taught me, both on and off track, have been, you know, irreplaceable, and stuff that I'll carry through for the rest of my life. So, again, I can't thank those guys enough from the bottom of my heart.
Awesome words, Jack. I mean, you can get the lessons. You've still got to take them on board, which you clearly have. So credit to you for that. Just talk us through that last lap again, because it looked like Franco might just hold you off. And then you made that move at turn 13. It really was the last opportunity you had.
Yeah. I was trying to get a move done on him earlier in the race. I felt like I had maybe a little bit more pace towards the end of the race. I'd saved the rear tyre quite well, especially on the left-hand side. But yeah, it was just... Especially here, you sort of roll into a lot of corners. You brake on the angle. So you find, like, the closing speed between you and another bike is a lot more sometimes, and it catches you off guard. And every time I felt like I'd get close enough, I'd nearly almost, like, nick the back of him and have to run wide, and you miss the apex then a little bit. So I just kept yo-yoing off him, and I'm like, ah. I looked, and it had, like, 4 laps left. I'm like, I'll just save it for the last lap and see what I can do. We had a tailwind again today, so I didn't get that massive advantage like we would like on the front straight, but nevertheless, we were able to get it done. And then in turn 14, I had to use every single ounce of turning power that Ducati had to try and keep it online and not open the door one little bit, because if I did, I know him and that Yamaha, they would have been up the inside. Quick, smart, but we were able to do so today, and really happy to finish the season off like this and go into next year in the red colours on a high note like this. It's incredible.
It's been a crazy, crazy season, Jack. Ups and downs for almost every single rider. You've had some real bad luck this year, which has cost you some crucial world championship points, but how will you look back on and reflect on 2020? Because there are so many positives for you to take.
There have been so many positives, but like many of us, I think we're going to look back and think, what could have been, you know?
Yeah.
There's the season of what could have been. Never seen a season, you know, like you say, I've had my share of bad luck, I've made my mistakes and whatnot, but so has everybody. And just to finish, I don't even know where I finished off in the championship, I think seven,
is it?
Yeah, so not too bad. Considering 4 DNFs, and we'll try our best for next year to try and straighten up that 7, hopefully.
Jack, it's always a pleasure to talk to you. Always awesome to watch you ride. It has been a fantastic 2020 season. We wish you all the luck in the official factory Ducati team next year, mate, in 2021. Have a great winter back at home in Australia.
Thank you very much. Yeah, back to summer for me, mate. So.
He's going to get some sunshine by the sounds of it, Stephen.
Awesome.
And
thanks,
well
guys.
Earned indeed. Back to you guys.
Yeah, thanks, Matt. Thanks to Jack, as ever. We love Jack. Great to see him end the season on a high. He's absolutely right when he says about maturing as well. We've seen that develop over the last couple of years.
Yep, we really have. He was a little bit of a wild boy when he was young, wasn't he, Jack?
He's still got a bit of that.
Yeah, but now he's got it balanced right, isn't it? Life's about a balance. He's got it really figured it out. And you just said you love him. We're talking about loving riders, though. Does anyone not love Jack? Like, just how hard he tries, how fast he is, and how he is in front of the camera. He's just, brilliant.
I'm not sure Jorge Lorenzo does, but then I'm not sure Jorge Lorenzo likes anyone at the moment, given what's going on social media. A fantastic effort from Jack. Just a quick word on his teammate, Pecco Bagnaia. He took a big whack from Joan Mir. He looked in some considerable pain.
Yeah, when I went to chat to the team, they said the impact. He's had a lot of shoulder trouble before, hasn't he, or his fair share. I suppose it's weaker or whatever, ligaments. And he said he felt it dislocate an instant pain and then go back in, but he was straight in the box going, well, so he's not doing any media duties tonight. He's off to get it checked out.
Oh, well, we wish Pecco Bagnaia all the best. Let's talk about...
Yeah, he's had a tough end to the season, but he's another amazing rider. He's shown glimpses that I think we're going to see more of that next year.
Okay, well, let's hope so for his sake. Best wishes to the Italians. Staying with Italians, staying with riders in the VI 46 Academy. It's another podium for Franco Morbidelli. He has secured the runners-up spot in the MotoGP World Championship. Congratulations to him. He's with Matt now. Over to you.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Steve. Yeah, I'm with a very happy Franco Morbidelli. Such a strong finish to 2020 for you, Franco, today with another podium, third after another very good fight with Jack Miller. You've taken second place in the World Championship, which was obviously your key target coming in to this weekend. You're the top Yamaha rider in 2020. So all in all, it's been a very positive ending to the year for you.
Yeah, I would say, yeah. I'm very happy with this season. It started not in the best way when I understood that I was gonna have a different package compared to the other guys. I can't hide that I was a little bit frustrated and it didn't feel good. But we were able to put this whole angry and frustration into the right direction, and we've put in a lot of work at the gym, at home, and we put in a lot of work with the crew, with Ramon, in order to squeeze the potential and to take out the potential, the maximum potential from our package, and that's what we've seen. We were able to work better, and we were able to exploit more the potential of the bike, especially in the back-to-back races. The second one, we were always super, super strong, and we were always able to understand well what we needed from the bike, and we were able to put it on track. So huge congratulations to the team. Huge congratulations to Ramon, but also huge thanks to Yamaha anyway, because the package that they supplied me is still a great package, and it still gave me the chance to fight for the position I wanted to fight for. I have to say that this COVID situation helped me to be more serious at home, to be more concentrated and more respectful of my job. And that's the key of this wonderful year.
You always speak so brilliantly and beautifully, Franco. You rode brilliantly again today. Unfortunately, the man to your right, standing here right now, Miguel Oliveira, was on a different level. You said in Parc Fermé he was untouchable. Were you surprised at just how strong he was throughout the entire race? He made the perfect start, built the gap, and I guess you maybe were hoping that he might run into some tyre problems, but it never happened. I mean, he ran an amazing race.
Yeah, well, Miguel was unbeatable today. I tried in the beginning to stay with him, to just stay with him, but I understood straight away that yet something more. Yeah, I was hoping for something to happen to him, but actually it happened to me. I destroyed the tire myself. But anyway, huge congratulations to him. He did a wonderful job in his home GP, and that's a great, great thing to win a race in your house and in such a beautiful track. So huge congratulations to him, and huge congratulations as well to Jack that was able to, how can I put it in a good way? He was able to overtake me at the end of the lap.
That was a very good and very polite way of describing the turn 13 move. Franco, you've already kind of reflected on 2020. It's been a brilliant year for you. Three victories, as many as any other Yamaha rider. I just want to get your thoughts quickly on 2021, because it's going to be a super special season. Valentino Rossi, who's done so much for you, is going to be your new teammate next year. So going into 2021, having had such a strong ending to this year, and with the boss joining you as well, there's a lot to look forward to next year.
Yeah, I'm excited. I'm excited. I'm looking forward to be Vale's teammate. We will have to dig deep this winter. We will work together, and we will dig deep to be strong next year and to be ready to give battles to the factory guys.
Congratulations, Frankie. You've had a fantastic season. Many congratulations on finishing second in the World Championship and top Yamaha. Top job.
Thank you.
Back to you guys in the studio.
Big hug to everyone. Ciao.
Thanks very much, Matt. Thanks to Franco Morbidelli. He really is turning into quite the weapon in MotoGP. Interesting there that he mentioned his frustration, Simon, at the start of the year about the package that he was given by Yamaha.
Oh, for sure. I mean, the thing is, I don't think any rider feels any different. You want to have the best kit. Yep. And it's so competitive. If you think you're not getting the same level equipment, you're just not happy. It's normal rider reaction. You know, you were going to say something?
I was just going to say that given that he started the season in that way and probably wouldn't have expected to be fighting for the World Championship the way he was at the end of this year, it makes you think just how strong he could be next year. Now he knows that he's there and he can win the races.
Yeah, completely. I think that happened to Joan Mir, you know, during the season, once he, from Austria on. Hey, look, the thing that I took from that, everyone can see why he's fantastic, you know. But the thing I took from it that was really important he put across was how they could go to a race, and those back-to-back ones, and be really strong the second one and prove, which to me takes good rider feedback, clever rider and crew chief team to do that, because it's not easy. And, that's why he's such a dangerous package, him, Ramon, you know, for next year.
Well, it was a very, very happy hunting ground here at home for Miguel Oliveira today. An absolute masterclass from Mount Miguel. He's down in the TV set with Matt. Over to you.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Steve. I think it's fair to say, Miguel, that was perfection in Portugal for you today. The perfect weekend, pole position, fastest lap of the race, and winning on your home circuit. It probably doesn't get much better than that, does it?
I don't think so. You know, it's one of the things that you dream about, but finally to be able to do it, it's special. It's nice to get a win like this. Austria was a nice win. I had a lot of adrenaline because it was a last corner overtake. But this one, it was really about managing the feelings throughout the whole race. And believe me, it was very, very long. But I was able to manage good, keep a cool mind, and try to enjoy as most as possible on the track.
It looked like you executed plan A absolutely perfectly. Make the start and then build up a gap that you could manage over Franco and Jack Miller. Was that exactly how it panned out for you?
That really relaxed me a lot, because already in the first lap, when I saw that I had a lap time of 40.0, I kind of already built my mental reference throughout the racetrack. And for me, to get this early gap was very relaxing. I could manage it and extend it a little bit further and really understand which lap times they were doing and how much gap could I have in my pocket at the end of the race. And, you know, just entering the 10 lap to go phase, it was more difficult to manage the feelings, but it was okay, because I had a good gap.
Unfortunately, we know there have been 100,000 fans here normally roaring you on here in the crowd. We know COVID-19, unfortunately, has prevented that, but at least your family and some of your friends were able to come to this weekend. How special was it when you crossed the line, winning in MotoGP in Portugal, and then coming to Parc Fermé to see all your family there? It must have been one of the greatest moments of your career.
I cannot tell you. Know, I know many guys in this paddock are much longer than me without seeing their families. And I know it's a huge effort, because we need to keep in this bubble. And when we go back home, we really need to see and filter which people do we need to see or that can we see, really. And, you know, This week, actually, I went to see my grandmother, you know, and I had to stand out on the street, and they were crying, and me too. And it's not nice, the phase we are living, but it's the reality. We need to adapt, and finally to have the privilege to be here with them and to live these emotions with them, I think is my highlight of this victory.
I just want to quickly talk about Tech 3, of course. You've had two fantastic years with them, a great relationship with Guy Coulon and Hervé Poncharal. It's been such a special year for them. And KTM as well. Your two victories have come in their home Grand Prix in Austria and now your home Grand Prix in Portugal. So you could not really have picked two better races to have won. How do you reflect and summarise what's been an incredible 2020, Miguel?
Good, you know, apart from the three zeros that I had, I felt like it was an okay season. I felt like in a couple of times I could have done a little bit better, one or two positions at the end of the race. But we need to be happy. We gained a lot of experience. We learned a lot. And this is what we need to carry as the most valuable thing into 2021.
Yeah, and the first time in 20 years that Tech 3 have won. Three times KTM have won this year. You've won two of them. How much are you looking forward to now working with the factory KTM team next year and making that next step where you can perhaps be fighting for wins on a weekly basis?
Well, it's a step we need to take if we want to fight for a championship. And the factory team just has more people working for the same goal. I feel they have different kind of tools to help me as develop as a rider. And that's what we want to do. And KTM wants to win, so it's a good marriage.
Well, if you're going to be a stronger Miguel Oliveira in 2021, I think the other riders better watch out, Miguel, because today was an absolutely incredible performance. You did not put a foot wrong. Huge congratulations. It's a special feeling to win your home Grand Prix, and you did it in such emphatic fashion. Hopefully, you can have a party in Portimao tonight.
Yeah, with five people.
With five people. Many congratulations, then, Miguel. We'll look forward to seeing you in 2021.
Thank you.
Back to you guys in the studio.
Yeah, thanks as ever there to a very happy Miguel Oliveira. Great words there. Great to hear from him.
Wow. You know, Miguel, that is the Miguel we saw in Moto2. And you know what I mean?
Yeah.
How strong, mentally strong, skilled. I didn't think he was going to do that today. I'll hands up. I thought there'd be him, Jack, Poll and Morbidelli, those four fighting away, and one of them, you know, three of them will be on the podium. But I've got to say, Matt Burt did pick it. He said Miguel was going to do that, and he did. So hats off to, but yeah, fantastic ride. Like, I mean, he's just stamped out any doubters that he deserves that ride in the factory team next year. And about Guy and Hervé, I know how he feels. I rode for them. They gave me my first an opportunity in my first year in Europe, and they're awesome guys to work with, and I'm sure he enjoyed it. But off to the factory team, nobody's going to say no to that.
No, absolutely not. Just quickly on Pol Espargaró, fourth place for him today. A couple of mistakes, but ultimately, I think just paying for where he was in the grid.
Yes, it obviously did. I agree with that. Yeah, paying for where he was on the grid. That front lose you spotted, that was terrifying. He obviously wasn't as comfortable, you know, and yes, he had to fight, but it just didn't seem the same pace as Miguel had something extra special, didn't he? You know, I thought Pol was going to be right there fighting with Franco and Jack.
It was a bit of a disastrous day for a few others out there. Unfortunately for Fabio Quartararo and Maverick Viñales, we knew Rossi would struggle, but yep. I mean, those two in particular had a really dark day here.
Yeah, I really hope we get to understand why, what it is doing this, whether it's Frankie on the Yamaha can do something special, you know, or there is a problem with the, or a bit of both, you know, with those new Yamahas, chassis-wise. They're really struggling, in case people weren't watching the early sessions, rear grip. They said they lacked rear grip on entry, mid-turn, to get it to turn and exit.
Dovi finished in sixth place, just behind Nakagami. Good result for Taka Nakagami to finish off the season, especially after the crashes yesterday. Bradl was just behind Dovi. A fantastic weekend for the Honda test rider. We wish Dovi all the best. Sad to see the back of him, but there's so exciting times coming up next year with all these new faces. Aleix Espargaró, eighth. Now, at the end of the race, his lap times were quicker than the leaders. That's really encouraging.
I actually got to catch up. Cut my way through the Aprilia team garage to get to here. And I said, how are you guys? And they went, oh, we've got half a smile, you know. So they salvaged something, you know. I'd like to throw out there again, just, you know, in the last show we're doing, that like I thought KTM were going to have a good year this year, I think, I actually said KTM lining up or aiming at their best season ever. I think, I get the feeling Aprilia can do that next year.
In general, Simon, this is the last After the Flag that we do for 2020. It's been an unbelievable season, but I suppose what it's given us is even more hunger and excitement about next year, because right across this grid, there are stacks of talent.
Yeah, and there's three more young fellas coming on the Ducatis.
Yeah.
You know, it's getting closer and closer and closer. You know what I'm saying? There's not many of the old guard left. No. And these new boys are ruthless, like, and fantastic. So, yeah, so I'm looking forward to next year.
Simon, thanks as ever for all your work here in 2020, and to Matt Burt as well. From all of us here at Dorna Sports, thanks for joining us. The final After the Flag is done. The final race is done. And we'll see you soon.
It's the final showdown of a memorable, unforgettable 2020 MotoGP World Championship. The final race of the season is underway. Really good start from Miguel Oliveira from pole position. Miguel Oliveira leads. There is Mir. He hits Johan Zarco and almost crashes. Here comes Jack Miller. You know he's going to have a... comes up the inside from Jack Miller. From Morbid. Holding firm around the outside.
Oh, I think Miller's got it.
The checkered flag comes out here in Portugal. Miguel Oliveira wins at home. And Miller finishes second, with Morbidelli in third, who will claim second in the World Championship.